I was panicking there. I left a couple things on the ground. But listen, delighted to be here, honored to be here. And I put that up there so you could see. It says the entire presentation documented with footnotes and PowerPoint shown today are available at the BMAF.org. So I talk fast, and if you try to take notes, you'll be frustrated. All right? But I want to bring greetings to you from all your relatives. Bonnie and I are just finishing a full-time mission for the LDS Church, and we teach out at the prison. All your relatives are saying hi. Yeah, okay. just teasing on that, of course. Now, I hope I get this right. There we go. It's incredibly important to understand the impact that the Law of Moses has on the Book of Mormon. And see if I can illustrate that to you by just sharing something here. Because for 634 years, the people in the Book of Mormon lived under the Law of Moses. Now, the part I'm going to show you right here, this first part, this is the index. I'm holding up the index and 30 pages of the Book of Ether. This narrow part represents 64 pages that are either New Testament or post-New Testament times, basically, here. And the rest of the Book of Mormon, this part right here, that is all under the Law of Moses. So the Law of Moses is a significant part. And what we're going to be talking about here, for example, let's see if I can get this here. Maybe I point it toward you, right? All right. We'll get this. And oh, there it is. Good. Point number one. Oh, no. We just mentioned that 634 years from the Exodus till First Nephi, from 1 Nephi 1:1 to 3 Nephi 15:4, you're going to find that entire period of time under that. And if we can just move along there. Okay, right here. Will that do it? Okay, no, that's going backwards. I want to get this. I'll get it here. We'll get you straightened out here. So on the right-hand side, like that, and like that. Okay, there you go. So there's your 437 pages of the Book of Mormon that are all under the Law of Moses. In other words, about 82% of the Book of Mormon. If you take out the 30 pages of the Book of Ether, which is that Jaredite time, then you're going to have closer to maybe 88% of the Book of Mormon is under the Law of Moses. So very, very significant of that. Now, the Book of Mormon itself, and what I'd like you to look at here, if you would, look at the dates. They're the ones that are kind of highlighted in white, and let's just go through that just a little bit here. If you'll notice that each one of these are going to be talking at a certain time period, and they're all bearing testimony to the fact that the Book of Mormon here, that these people kept the Law of Moses. Now, see if I can coordinate with you here, and we get on the same page. When you have Mormon's abridgment, he's going to make some things. It's a little harder for me to read that there. I do have a copy here, but let's see if I can kind of read that with you here together. And we did observe to keep the judgments and the statutes and the commandments of the Lord in all things. This is going to mean the Passover. This is going to mean they kept all of the ordinances that were a part of the Law of Moses. Very, very important. And then we move from 570 down to 550, and we kept the Law of Moses, the performances and ordinances of God until the law shall be fulfilled. That's the 550 down to 530. And we did keep the Law of Moses and until the law should be fulfilled. That's the brother of Nephi, of course, Jacob. And then Jerem. Now, 200 years had passed away, and the people of Nephi had waxed strong in the land, and they observed to keep the Law of Moses and the Sabbath day holy. And we're going to get a couple more of these. By the way, the paper is about 27 pages long, and I have more than 110 references that are documented there for you to look at. This is just a scattering of them, okay? I'm not going to go to all that, just give you an idea again. But here's Abinadi, and he's going to say, it's expedient that we should keep the Law of Moses as yet. Salvation doth not come by the law alone, were it not for the atonement. This is going to be a really important concept, that the Book of Mormon people were atonement And eventually I'm going to we'll explain the concept of lamb-centered. They were very much centered in the concept of the lamb versus the lion. We'll talk about that in just a minute. But we're talking about 148 BC. Now we're going to get to Mosiah in 124 BC, and he's going to say, and they also took the firstlings of their flock, that they might offer sacrifices and burnt offerings according to the law of Moses. King Mosiah, 121. They did walk in the ways of the Lord, and did observe his judgments and statutes, and did keep his commandments, and it's in the law of Moses in all things. Now, so when you're talking about keeping the commandments of the Lord in the Book of Mormon, you're talking about up to that period of time, that 437 pages, you're talking about keeping the commandments of the law of Moses. That's what that's going to have reference to. Alma is going to say at 90 BC, and they did walk in the ways of the Lord and did observe to keep his commandments and statutes. Yea, they did keep the law of Moses. They did look forward to the coming of Christ. Now we're going to get Alma again in 74 BC, and they were strict in observing the ordinances of God according to the law of Moses until it should be fulfilled. And then just the last little group of, there we go. And that's going to be Mormon's abridgment now. He's going to say, this is at the birth of Christ. A few began to preach. It was no more expedient to observe the law of Moses. They were soon convinced of the error which they were in, for the law was not yet fulfilled. Then we find out about the faithful Lamanites around 6 AD, did observe strictly to keep the commandments of God according to the law of Moses. And then again, the faithful Lamanites around 29 to 30, willing with all diligence to keep the commandments of the Lord. Now when the Savior comes, 3 Nephi 15 and 34 AD, is going to say, behold, I say unto you that the law is fulfilled, it was given unto Moses. He's going to say, I am the law, I gave the law, and it's now fulfilled every jot and tittle, all things said about the prophets and in the law and the prophets about me has been fulfilled regarding the jot and tittle of the law of Moses. And then finally in Mormon's abridgment of 4th Nephi, and boy is there a contrast between the law of Moses and as they start living in 4th Nephi. You're going to see there was no contention among them. They had all things in common. I mean, there is a significant change that's going to take place there. But this observation is made by Mormon. And they did not walk anymore after the performances and ordinances of the law of Moses. That particular time was going to be passed for them. So this is the lamb imagery that I had reference to. The lamb, it's really significant. The Book of Mormon people, when they left, when Lehi left Jerusalem, they left with the concept of the Messiah who's going to come, and they had the concept of the atonement. And it was really centered very much in Isaiah chapter 53, which is also Mosiah 14. So these people had that. It's a very significant thing. 67 direct references to the Lamb of God in the Book of Mormon. And in case we have any doubt about did they really think the lamb symbolism was of God, the Messiah, who is the Lamb of God, the Lamb of God is the Son of God, and if the Lamb of God, he being holy, should need to be baptized by water, just going like that. Now, the lion image of the Lord is certainly a part of the Old Testament. For example, if you get the lion images in Jeremiah, they're scattered throughout the Old Testament. And it does talk about the idea that when the Lord comes at the second time. Now, this is an interesting point, because you see, even the disciples in the days of Jesus, his 12 apostles, didn't know that Christ was going to come again till Matthew 24, when it says, and then his disciples understood that he was going to come again. Well, there's a fundamental difference between what happens during the exilic period, that's when the Jews are carried away to Babylon, and what happens out of those traditions contrasted with the Book of Mormon that's going to have a more pure form of following the lamb-centered atonement. So they were not really looking forward, even in the Book of Mormon, to this lion concept. So you're going to find the concept of a lion 8 times during the period of time we're talking about, the 437 or so pages there up under the Old Testament, but those 5 lion references, there's 8 altogether, lion and lions, and if you put them all together, 7 of those references are talking about the millennial time where the lion's going to lay down with the lamb. Now, if it's before that time, the lion's going to have lamb for lunch, but after this, there's all 7 of the 8 are anyway dealing with millennium, and the 8th one refers to the people, not to Christ himself. There are no lion references to the coming Messiah in the Book of Mormon during that Old Testament period of time, and so what that says is these people were prepared in the Book of Mormon to talk about the coming Messiah and the atonement, and they understood that. They understood it very clearly. We're going to contrast that with what happens in traditional Judaism and what the effects of that were when they were carried away into that Babylonian captivity, that whole period of time right there. So, moving right along, this is the dichotomy that I had referenced to. And that is what happens with the Book of Mormon Jews. There, as I say, they're Isaiah 53 centered. And just in case we need to kind of review that, let me just share a thought with you here. This is going to be Isaiah 53. Let me read also a reference to you about the lion in Jeremiah 49:19. So here's the reference to Christ in verse 7. This is Isaiah. He was oppressed, he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before his shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Now, that's the concept of the Messiah as a lamb. Interestingly enough, you're going to have four major animals representing Christ. If I have time, we'll talk about those later, but you're going to have Christ as an eagle, Christ as a serpent, all right? A lot of people have a problem with that one, but that's all right. You're going to have Christ as a lion and Christ as a lamb, the four major animals. And in the New World, we find that the serpent, the lion, of course, and the eagle is also very, very much a part of the New World, both in South America and also in Mesoamerica. But if we have time, we'll go there. Now, here's the imagery of the lion. This is Jeremiah 49:19. Behold, he shall come up like a lion from the swelling of Jordan against the habitation of the strong. But I will suddenly make him, and then it goes on to say, and appoint a great king over the people. But this is the concept of a lion. So you've got the lion and the lamb. And my point is that the Book of Mormon was preparing the people for the coming of Christ as they expected him to come. And that was as a lamb. And they were atonement-centered. So if I use the word lamb, think of atonement. That this is the Savior going to carry out that divine mission, the mission of overcoming physical death and spiritual death. So that's a part of the lamb mission. The lion one is very interesting because in the traditional concept of the lion coming, there are people that among the Jewish people, there's different beliefs on that, but primarily they believe he's going to come and just save the Jewish nation and gather the Jews together and build the third temple and have an heir who will reign after him, be very much like Cyrus and things, who was in Persia. We'll get a chance, if we get a chance to talk about that, we'll go there. And let's move along. Are you keeping up? Are you all right with this? All right. Babylonian Jews, they became Torah-centered. They lost the lamb. Lamb's gone. But they did not lose the concept of the lion. And I can understand that. And they can find the lion representation in the Old Testament, but which they would call the Law, the Prophets, and the Psalms. But they adopted some traditions there, and I'll talk about that in a minute or two here. Zoroastrianism. It's a Persian religion. Esther marries a Zoroastrian, all right? And I'm just saying that it was very dominant. I don't think they were influenced with the Babylonian calendars, we'll see, but more than that, they were influenced by the culture and the theology of Zoroastrianism. So when they come back, they're looking for the kind of Messiah that Zoroastrianism had, and his name is Shaoshant, and we'll talk about him here if we get a chance, which I think we will. Point number two, modern-day prophets, okay? Modern-day prophets and scholars, what they had to say about the Law of Moses in the Book of Mormon. Here's just a few. President John Taylor, it appears indubitably from the two records, the Bible and the Book of Mormon, that the intent and true meaning of the Law of Moses and of its sacrifices were far better understood and comprehended by the Nephites than by the Jews. Now, I love the Jewish people. If I make any statements that appear to be derogatory towards them, I don't mean that at all. In my heart of hearts, I love the Jewish people. I admire their devotion. But I'm talking theology and history. And so that's the context of what I'm saying here. Elder Jeffrey R. Holland makes the statement, it's important to understand that for more than 600 years, the descendants of Lehi observed the Law of Moses. Neil A. Maxwell, the Book of Mormon peoples, though Christians, were tied very much more strictly to the pre-exilic Law of Moses. Now, that's a wonderful term. Pre-exilic means exile, and before they were exiled. So pre-exilic is before the exile. They were much more tied. He was a word master, of course, Neil Maxwell. But they were much more tied to the law of Moses until Jesus came than we in the church fully appreciated. Other scholars of the Book of Mormon, like Hugh Nibley and Jack Welch and Gary Gillum and Don Norton, have all supported the fact that the prophet historians of the Book of Mormon kept, quote, the law of Moses, but in everything anticipated the coming of the Mashiach, the Messiah, and the new covenant, end of quote. Stephen Ricks, William Hamblin agreed, quote, the Nephites observed the law of Moses in all respects, including its requirements and proscriptions. Now, a proscription is what you shouldn't do, and a prescription is what you should do. Okay, so prescriptions and proscriptions, and there's both of them in the law of Moses, and they're going to do that. Paul Chessman, in his early research in the Book of Mormon, noted that the Book of Mormon prophets, quote, observed the moral injunctions and the ritual aspects of the law of Moses, end of quote. Susan Easton Black concurred, while they kept the law of Moses, they looked forward with steadfastness to Christ, end of quote. Just a couple more. Monty Nyman, Charles Tate wrote, the Book of Mormon confirms the fact that the Nephites lived the law of Moses until Jesus said it was fulfilled when he visited them after his resurrection in Jerusalem. B.H. Roberts recognized that the Nephites offered sacrifices and administered in their ordinances in the law of Moses, which the Nephites were commanded to observe. Orson Pratt makes some interesting statements. He said to the early Latter-day Saints that the Book of Mormon worshipped according to the law of Moses until they were taught and received the gospel. On another occasion, Orson Pratt would be more specific. They, having kept the law of Moses, I mean the Nephites, look forward according to the testimony of the law for the coming of the Messiah, that is, the great prophet of Israel, which Moses had told them that the Lord would raise up unto them. They look forward to that great prophet to come and shed his blood for their sacrifices and burnt offerings, pointed to a great and last sacrifice, the sacrifice of the Son of God. The Nephite nation, therefore, had a testimony given to them concerning the future Messiah that was to come, end of quote. Well, what we're saying here is that modern prophets and scholars recognize then that the people in the Book of Mormon lived under the law of Moses, and they lived under the complete law of Moses, but not the law of Moses that comes out of the Judean, Babylonian, captivity, Persian concept. There is so much that was added to that. For example, no Talmuds, no Mishnah, no yarmulkes, no prayer shawls, no, all of that stuff was added. And I had a class here the other night. My wife and I, one of the things we do is teach a young adult class in addition to teaching out at the prison. And so I asked this question. I said, I'd just like to know, I'm gonna put this on the board. I just want your honest answers. How many have a positive feeling towards the law of Moses? How many have a somewhat positive feeling? How many have a neutral feeling? How many have a somewhat negative feeling? How many have a negative feeling? Two people said they had a positive feeling about the law of Moses. Okay, about 80, I guess, in the class. Why do we have maybe more of a negative attitude about the law of Moses? And the answer is the New Testament. See, the New Testament, the Savior, for example, in Matthew 23, is going to be chastising. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Well, it's because they were living the law of Moses in an apostate form, and according to the Savior, and therefore they're straining at gnats and swallowing camels, those kind of things, whited sepulchers, beautiful on the outside, but full of dead men's bones on the inside. So a lot of the statements made by the Savior, which appear to reflect the law of Moses, it's just not true. Because, see, the Lord does not give any commandments, and that's what we're going to look at right here, I believe, and that the Lord doesn't give any commandments that are not spiritual commandments, and the concept in section 29 of the Doctrine and Covenants as well. But here, look at this here, the big picture. Heavenly Father's work in glory, it's to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of his children. He loves them. He wants us all to come back to his presence. And so in the process of that, he assigns his son, Jehovah Christ, to be in charge of this earth, maybe many other earths like into it, but at least this earth here. And then Adam is going to get assigned under Christ to be over these various dispensations of the gospel. All things are given of God are spiritual, all right? Never do I give a temporal commandment. All my commandments are spiritual, the Lord's going to say. We have Christ over Adam, and then you're going to have here the seven dispensations of the gospel. And let's see if we can just point something out here. I know it's a little hard maybe to read because it looks like it's doubled up down there, but of the first dispensation, it's Abel, the prophet Joseph said in teachings, page 169, he says that Abel is holding the keys of his dispensation. He's going to get killed, and Seth is going to be the acting president of the dispensation. But Abel is holding still. So Abel's over the first dispensation. Adam's over all of them, okay, under Christ. But Abel's the first dispensation. Then you're going to go Abel, Enoch, Noah, and then Abraham. And the interesting thing about Abraham is in Galatians 3 and 8, you're going to have the statement that's going to be made there by Paul that Abraham was taught the gospel. And what we're going to find is that all of these dispensations were introduced to the higher law of Christ. Now, we're going to call the law of Moses a lesser law and the higher law of Christ. And we're going to see some of those differences, what it really meant. But the Moses dispensation is going to kind of stand out here. The other two dispensations are going to be Peter and then Joseph Smith. And I don't know how they got quenched up like that, but they did, and that's okay. Important to remember, the people, I didn't use that script, but I like it. It's nice. The people of Moses were unprepared. In other words, the Lord practices an interesting principle with his children. He'll tailor-make the plan of salvation to kind of help them out. I used to write curriculum for the LDS Church, and I was assigned to work with Elder McConkie, and I remember one occasion Elder McConkie came in, and he asked me, he goes, he had a beautiful, deep voice and such a wonderful man, "Brother Lund, are there daughters of perdition?" My mouth dropped open. I looked at him, and I was sitting at the corner of his desk writing my little red pencil on a manuscript, and I said, "I don't know." "That is the correct response. I've just come from the office of the president of the church, and he said he didn't know either." So sometimes that's the right answer. I don't know, right? But the thing I do know is that later Elder McConkie asked me, he said, "How many plans of salvation were there?" And I was ready with my "I don't know" answer. But I said, "I thought there was one great plan." Elder McConkie responded, "There's an individual plan for each one of our Heavenly Father's children. Heavenly Father tailor makes the plans of salvation. And sometimes for groups, he has to tailor make that plan of salvation. So for the people that we're talking about right now under the law of Moses, that was and DNC 84 is going to tell us that it was a preparatory gospel, a preparatory one, to prepare them for the higher law. So rather than just take them all out, these people have been under the traditions of Egypt. So that wicked one cometh and taketh away light and truth through disobedience and because of the traditions of the fathers. That's section 93:39. But so Paul's statement was that Moses, that the law of Moses was their schoolmaster to bring them unto Christ. So that was the intent of the law of Moses. It's a spiritual intent. So it's not. There's nothing less than that. Let me read you a part of section 84 of the Doctrine of Covenants. "Now this Moses plainly taught to the children of Israel in the wilderness and sought diligently to sanctify his people that they might behold the face of God," that we might refer to as the second comforter. "But they hardened their hearts and could not endure his presence. Therefore the Lord in his wrath, for his anger was kindled against them, swore that they should not enter into his rest," which rest is the presence of God, "which rest in the wilderness, which rest is the fullness of his glory. Therefore he took Moses out of their midst and the holy priesthood also, and the lesser priesthood continued, which priesthood holdeth the keys of the ministering of angels and the preparatory gospel." And then it goes on to talk about some elements of that preparatory gospel. Which gospel is the gospel of repentance and of baptism and remission of sin and the law of carnal commandments. Now, the concept of carnal commandments means those commandments dealing with blood sacrifices. So it's still a spiritual law, and you'll realize that from the dispensation, when Adam leaves the Garden of Eden and goes out and is going to offer up a lamb and make a sacrifice, and the Lord's going to ask him some questions about why he's doing that, and he's doing it, "I don't know, except I've been commanded to do it," that kind of a thing. They're going to be offering sacrifices through all of these dispensations from Abel, as it were, all the way down until Christ is going to die on the cross, and that's going to end the blood sacrifices. But they still had animal sacrifice all the way through until that particular period of time. Our dispensation doesn't have it now, and I'm not worried about it either. But this other idea of the Savior, you know, in John 14, he's going to say, "I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you." Well, Fortunately, we don't have to be so perfect in this life that we have to have that experience in order to return to the presence of our Heavenly Father. But it was something that is a part of the higher law of Christ that was available. And let me just share a couple of quick little scriptures with you on that. One of them is going to be here in section 93 of the Doctrine and Covenants, verse 1. Verily, verily, thus saith the Lord, it shall come to pass that every soul who forsaketh his sins and cometh unto me and calleth on my name and obeyeth my voice shall see my face and know that I am. And we have that same message in section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants, verse 67. And if your eye be single to my glory, your whole body shall be filled with light, and there shall be no darkness in you, and that body which is filled with light comprehendeth all things. Therefore, sanctify yourselves, that your minds become single to God, and the days will come that you shall see him, for he will unveil his face unto you, but it shall be in his own time, and in his own way, and according to his own will. My point in mentioning that is that the purpose of the law of Christ is to prepare us to return to our Heavenly Father. So here's kind of a three-tiered thing that we're talking about. We want to go back to the presence of the Heavenly Father, but nobody goes to the Father unless they go through Christ. And that's what he says in John 14 also. But nobody's going to go to Christ if it doesn't go through the Holy Ghost. Well, having then the higher priesthood and the Holy Ghost, now taken out of the dispensation of Moses, was a major thing to do. But the Lord left them with, in addition to these, what we might think about, well, all those animal sacrifices, it just confuses me. I mean, a heave offering, a wave offering, a thank offering, a trespass offering, a sin offering, a whole burnt offering. I mean, you get a little lost in all of that. And yet, it was all designed, and every detail of that pointed toward Christ. It pointed toward one aspect of his earthly mission or a part of his divine spiritual mission. Every detail of the law of Moses. And I'm going to try to illustrate that here in just a minute. In particular, just to go move on here. This is a great principle, the principle that the Lord practiced with the law of Moses, strategic retreat. Now, all you have to do to understand the concept of strategic retreat is have one teenager. One teenager will do it. I'll give you an example. You may not go to that dance tonight. If you go to that dance, I want you home by 12 o'clock. If you're not home by 12 o'clock, I want you to call and let me know that you're safe. You know what that's called? Strategic retreat. When I was in Air Force ROTC at BYU, we were given, there was a course called orienteering. You're given a map and a compass, and they drop you in a wilderness area, and you're supposed to pick out the spot that you could defend, that you could also be picked up from when a Jolly Green Giant helicopter comes in and picks you up. And so you're supposed to be able to identify on a map, and then you couldn't just one spot. You had to then retreat to the second best position, and then to a third, then you go back to the classroom and defend it, all right? And everybody went through that process. That's strategic retreat. And the Lord does that according to the preparation of the children of men at different times, even under the fullness of the law of Christ. And we're all individually progressing under the general law of Christ. And we're certainly not all at the same levels. Most of you are highly, highly more advanced. Anyway, when the Lord goes up the first time in Deuteronomy 9, and you're familiar with that, he's going to have the higher law of Christ, and he's going to come down with that. But here we've got them out there, they're dancing, and they're doing all the weird stuff that they shouldn't be doing, and by the traditions of the golden calves and all of that. And so they're going to cast down those tables of stone. He's going to go back on a second trip, and he's going to come down now, instead of the full law of Christ, he's going to come down with the law of Moses. And that's what we're going to take a look at. So how does that dispensation of the law of Moses, how was that different, for example, than the other dispensations which were under the law of Christ? Well, here's what it looks like. Look at the right-hand side up there, and you'll see that under the law of Christ, you're going to have obedience, sacrifice, faith, repentance, baptism, prepare for the Messiah, an Aaronic priesthood temple, also animal sacrifice. Well, now we look over to the law of Christ. Obedience, sacrifice, faith, repentance, baptism, animal sacrifice until Christ dies. But then you're going to get the higher ordinances in yellow there. Discipleship to the Messiah, the Holy Ghost, consecration, Melchizedek priesthood, higher temple ordinances, second comforter, that kind of a thing. All of that's a part of the higher law of Christ. And I like to think of it as a glass that's half full. Rather than think of the law of Moses as just being, you know, totally inferior in some ways here, I want you to look at that, because if you look, it's faith, repentance, baptism, obedience, sacrifice, Aaronic priesthood. So it's a glass that's half full. All right, it's half empty, but it's half full. Whereas you go to the other side and you see under the law of Christ, these other things are then added and fills up the glass the rest of the way. So the law of Moses is not way out there. It's something that's in the middle here to kind of prepare the people to be able to receive that higher. And this is the Book of Mormon. These people were under that lesser law. Now, I believe that some of the prophets have Melchizedek priesthood. Did some of the prophets have the ability to have the companionship of the Holy Ghost? Yes. That can come by divine investiture as well as other things, but we'll take a look at that here in just a minute. Point number five, there is a significant difference between the law of Moses and the law of Christ, and it's the kind of love that's required to live each law. This is fascinating. This is really, really fascinating. Let's take a look at this. When Jesus in John 13:34 says, "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you." How is loving one another a new commandment? That's not a new commandment, is it? Look, it says in Deuteronomy 6:5, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy breath," actually, is the word there, soul, breath, "and with all your energy." And you say, well, isn't that it? Well, about Leviticus 19:18, "Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." No, there is a new commandment. And the new commandment, see, I have to go through a little bit of an explanation on this. The word love is found 130 times in the Old Testament, various forms of it, more than that, but 130 times. And the word that's used there 113 of those times is aheb. And aheb means brotherly love and deep abiding affection. It's a level like this. It's equivalent in Greek is philos, as in Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. It's these two are absolute. It's like saying Christos and Messiah, because Christos means the anointed one, Christ, and Messiah means the anointed one in Hebrew. So you have that one word in Hebrew, one word in Greek. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew, and the New Testament is written in Greek. So, but I'm going to tell you that the love that the Old Testament had to live was aheb. And aheb is philos, and philos is brotherly love. And Christ is saying, under the law of Christ, I don't want you to love that way anymore. I want you to love as I have loved you. This is the new commandment, to love as I have loved you. Whoa. Oh, that's a different level of love. It's a significant different level of love. To love your neighbor as yourself, as opposed to loving as Christ had loved you. So when you get into the Beatitudes are actually an explanation where Christ is going to say, you've heard it said of them of old that thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, here's that higher law of love. Love your enemies? What? It's a higher law of love. Now, remember when John is and Peter, James, and John are going up in the Galilee. They're fishing. This is the Savior's resurrected. He's on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. This is in John chapter 21. And on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, the Savior's there, and they come up, and now Peter has this conversation with Jesus. And now let me give it to you in the Greek. This is really significant because it's different. In English, they take the word love and they translate it the same way all the way through. So it didn't matter which form of Greek word it was. They just say love, love, love in English. Well, let's go to the Greek. Simon Barjona, agapius thou me. Agape is the pure love of Christ. It's charity. And it's a higher form of love. It's not philos. So it's charity, the higher form of love, as I have loved you. Simon Barjona, agapius thou me. Well, Lord, thou knowest that I philos thee. Then feed my sheep of me. Now in the Greek it says of me. And that's more than just feeding the hungry. It's feeding them of Christ. So feed my lambs of me. Simon Barjona, agapius thou me? Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest I philos thee. Feed my sheep of me. Simon Barjona, philos thou me. If you don't love me with this level of love, do you love me with this level? With this level here, do you? As a brother with abiding affection? And it grieved Peter that the Lord would ask him a third time, Philos thou me. And I think there's a lot to be said about that. And then the Savior says, then feed, if you have this level of love, and not this one even, feed my sheep of me. Powerful. But do you see the difference between the level of and the kind of love required to live the higher law of Christ, and yet the law of Moses was here? Do I believe that there were people in the Book of Mormon that was able to break through and do that? You bet. Let's take a look at that. Or we'll try to take a look at that. The new commandment was to love as Christ loved, agape, which is greater than loving, philos, one's neighbor as thyself. Just went through that. And you see that in 4th Nephi. In 4th Nephi, you're going to see these people living a higher level. It makes this observation at least four times in 4th Nephi. And there was no contention among them. See, they were living kind of DNC 121, reproving betimes with sharpness when moved upon by the Holy Ghost, where those kind of under the law of Moses are moved upon by frustration, moved upon by disappointment, moved upon by a lot to be contentious and things, right? So the idea here is it's a higher law that they were living. Anyway, in a vision shown to the prophet Nephi, you're going to find that the word charity is found eight times under the law of Moses era, and it's going to be in a vision for Nephi that he's going to be prophesying about the coming Messiah. And in talking about the coming Messiah, he's going to say four times in 2 Nephi 26 and 30, and then he's going to mention three times in 2 Nephi 33, 7, 8, and 9. But those are the references to charity, and I believe then he says, I have charity for my people, I have charity for the Jews, I have charity for the Gentiles, because the Lord has taught him the concept. And I really believe that's where that's being. And there are people who can rise to that level to do that. And I think some of our prophets and leaders and others during that time period did. Then Alma, who in chapter 7, when it says, and he's going to be born of Mary, and he's going to be born in Jerusalem, in the land of Jerusalem, then that same kind of a visionary thing, he's going to mention the concept of, after what I've seen, I know that we have to develop now a higher form of love. We have to have faith and hope and charity. Interesting. Faith, hope, and charity. Those are the only eight references there are to charity under that law of Moses. And I think, and they're introduced in the context of the Redeemer and the Savior. Okay, point six. Every jot and tittle of the law of Moses pointed toward the Messiah's mortal or spiritual mission. And it was a preparation for the higher covenant of love. Every detail. Now, I think I can, here's the problem that I have. I'm going to tell you right now. I could spend an hour and a half on the lepers and show to you each detail of how in the cleansing of a leper, every detail of that cleansing points towards Christ. I can't because my wife won't let me. All right. No, time-wise, we'd run out. She said, you'll never get a chance to do that. So I'm just going to be arbitrary. Let's go down to the two birds that are clean. A leper had to live away from the people. He had to be separated. It says to live alone, and the word alone there in the Hebrew is apart. They had to live separate. And often the lepers would live in little colonies together. Remember, the Savior's going to encounter 10 lepers on the road. But they had to cover uncover their heads. They had to cover their face here, this part, with gauze. And they had to cry out in Aramaic, Tema, Tema, which means unclean, unclean. And if they didn't do that, the punishment was 40 stripes, which for lepers would actually tear off their skin. Just tear it off. So a very terrible thing. There were some skin diseases that we wouldn't call leprosy, psoriasis or something, and other things that may have been judged at the time to think that people might have had leprosy, but they really didn't. But nevertheless, let's go down to the two birds. First of all, if you they're going to take one of these birds, and it's going to represent the blood atonement of Christ, and they're going to take two earthen pots, and one priest is going to pour, and by the way, it has to be two priests, because it only takes one priest to get you kicked out, but it takes two priests to bring you back in, because in the mouth of two witnesses should all truth be established. Where does that relate to the life of Christ? Jesus is going to stand, and he's going to say, John the Baptist bears witness of me, and my Father bears witness of me, and there's my two witnesses. Boom. It's great. Anyway, back down to the two birds. So he's going to take one bird. Now, think of Doctrine and Covenants, section 19. I, God, have suffered these things for all, that they might not suffer. If an animal was going to be sacrificed, it could not suffer. If it did, it was not a kosher kill. You had to go get another animal. So the way they did that was to pinch kind of the artery and cut it at the same time, and the animal would slowly bleed out. Now think of that in contrast to the Romans and the Greeks. When they made their sacrifices, like on a bull or something, they would put a rope around the neck, put a stick in it, and start twisting the stick. You know how much the animal would suffer, and they're kicking, and they're all over the whole place. And so the first century Christians were told to avoid eating meat that was from any strangled animal, and also meats that had been offered up to idol gods and things, but especially the strangled animals. They weren't supposed to do that. Because why? Because Christ is going to suffer for all people. So that bird now, his blood is going to be mixed with the water, and the blood and the water in that sense symbolizes the birth and the death of Christ. It really does. The birth, blood and water come forth. He's on the cross, they pierce his side, and out comes blood and water. Every detail of this cleansing process, I told you I could rant and rave on this, and this is a great thing to point out how the law of Moses was intended to point the minds of the people towards that future coming Messiah. It's a tender, tender story. Somebody that's out there, despised of men and rejected and living alone, they're going to be brought back in as a covenant son and daughter. They'll come to the temple, and when they're there at the temple, finally, after going through this whole process, I like the fact, I will show you this part right here. This is a cedar stick, which is symbolic of the temple, by the way, the Temple of Solomon and the Hiram of Tyre, and bringing down the cedars of Lebanon for the temple. And then you've got the scarlet thread. Think of Isaiah, though your sins be as scarlet. You have that. And then you have the hyssop. Now, hyssop was used to put the lamb's blood on the door of the lentils and on the post in Egypt. They used that, the hyssop with the lamb's blood, to mark the post. But also hyssop is going to be used with the Savior at the very end when they hold up that vinegar on a hyssop stick. Okay, and offer it to the Savior there, that vinegar with a sponge and things like that. But what you're going to do is they're going to take that stick, they're going to take the scarlet thread, and think of a parsley or something like that. And we're going to take that parsley, we're going to put it on the end of the stick, and we're going to wrap that thread around it. Now I've got a brush. And the priest is going to take that brush, and he's going to stick it into the blood and the water, and he's going to sprinkle it on the man seven times. And each time, seven represents what? Whole or complete. So he's going to say, "Thou art clean. Thou art clean." Seven times. Later on, what's going to happen, I'll have to jump ahead. I know I could go on this, but here we go. By the way, that's why it's in the paper. All the things in the paper. So you can read the paper and find out the correlations and the details on that. That's why it's there for you. But if you go down the very end, and you're going to see that here, the Lord now, the priest is going to put his hands on the head of this lamb. You have to offer two male lambs. One's a trespass offering, one's a sin offering. And then they're going to finally offer a ewe as the final offering. And why a ewe? This is speculation on my part. Because the tradition among them, and it's also a speculation among some of the Jews, by the way, but is that women were more submissive to the Lord. And if you go to any church, you usually find more women in the church than you do men. Almost pick a religion, doesn't seem to matter. And so the concept of the ewe was one of complete submission to the Lord. And so that's the final sacrifice. But with the trespass offering and with the sin offering, now here's what the priest is going to do. He's going to stick his finger in the neck of the blood of the lamb, and he's going to anoint the tip of the right ear, the tip of the thumb of the right hand, and the big toe on the right foot. And he's going to do it with blood, and then he's going to repeat it with oil. And out of the Mishnah, we have a tradition, but I don't know if it's the right one. It's because it comes out of the traditions. But in the concept was basically this. May you hear the word of the Lord. May your hand be stretched forth in doing goodness all the days of your life. And may your feet carry you on a path of righteousness. And to me, it's a very tender story. This person is going to accept the benefits of the atonement of Jesus Christ, and they're now coming as a covenant son or daughter back into the congregation of the righteous and their family. Think of when you went to pick up missionaries, and they've been gone for 18 months, they've been gone for 2 years or 2.5 years in some cases in my day, and after 2.5 years or so, you're there at the airport, and then that moment when they come through, boy, is that... just a touching moment. Well, this is a leper who has now been, through the atonement, cured and brought back into the camp of Israel. They were despised of men. They weren't even allowed to talk to people. They had to live alone and apart and cry out Tema. So anyway, lots of interesting things about that. But moving right along, the point is that all things pointed to Christ in the law of Moses. And quoting Alma 34 now, and behold, this is the whole meaning of the law, every whit pointing to that great and last sacrifice. And the great and last sacrifice will be the Son of God. Is there any question in your mind at all that the people in the Book of Mormon had a correct concept and understanding? They weren't encumbered by all of those traditions that got picked up in the Babylonian captivity. They weren't. They kept that pure law, and they were looking forward not for the lion. They're looking for the Lamb of God, who's going to come and take care of the atonement. And so the Book of Mormon, it's another testament of Jesus Christ. Wow. Wow. All right. A key to understanding the Book of Mormon is that the Jews, the Book of Mormon Jews, is that they remained lamb-centered, atonement-centered, but still followed the protocols and prescriptions of the law of Moses. Now, these are questions I want to ask Lehi. I'm just throwing this in here. I want to know, were you the rightful owner of the brass plates? Now, why would you send your son to somebody unless you weren't? Okay, I can't prove anything on that, but I think he might have been the oldest member of that particular Manasseh clan, and Laban was probably a relative, and Laban was keeping the place, but I can't prove that. I got to ask Nephi and Lehi. I got to find that out. Also, which one of the 12? Remember, the son is going to come down, and the 12 apostles are going to come, and one of them comes forth and gives him the book. I want to know who that was. All right? I don't know yet. We don't. And was the book you were given the brass plates? Was he given the brass? Is that what he was given? And then in 1 Nephi 13, he's going to actually, by the way, he's going to read from the brass plates. He's going to read, well, if they're the brass plates, the book that he was given, he's going to read from that. But what he's going to say there is, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, and it's really, I believe, a quote from Isaiah 29:1, where the word in Isaiah is used as Ariel, but Ariel is a synonym for Jerusalem. So I wonder if you read that. Anyway, another about a psalm and stuff. Now, those are my questions on the first chapter and the first 14 verses. I've got a lot of questions that I want to talk to these brethren about. And it does go back to that issue of, you know what, don't lose faith in what you know because of what you don't yet know. Just don't do it. It's a foolish thing to do. We can get a spiritual testimony, and then we'll build on that. And from that point, with our spiritual testimony, and one of only two things can happen, folks. Either we get a testimony that Joseph Smith is a prophet of God, in which case the Book of Mormon is true. We get a testimony the Book of Mormon is true, in which case Joseph Smith is a prophet of God. And that's why I feel that a great burden taken off my shoulders. I don't have to prove to anybody the truthfulness of the Book of Mormon. The Lord has taken that as his personal responsibility, and through the Holy Ghost, he will be able to bear witness to the souls of the children of men. We just have to be in a position where we try to be the best examples that we can, and on the other hand, and bear testimony, and let the Holy Ghost be responsible for converting people and taking the message to them on that. Anyway, let's move right along here. Point seven, there are some implications of living the law of Moses in all things in the Book of Mormon. Some very positive and interesting, keeping the law of Moses. Well, did they have sheep for the Passover? And what about the calendar? And are there Jewish symbols in America? Now, some of you have seen this before. Look at the chest. Look at the chest. Does that look like the Star of David to you on his chest? Can you see it? You can't see it. Only the righteous can see it. Okay. Right there. Okay. Look at boom, boom, boom. And then here, down like that. That, by the way, it's believed by many that not only did the high priest wear those 12 colored stones on his chest, precious gems to represent the 12 tribes of Israel, but that he had the Star of David below that would flip out like this, and those two spots on the two edges of it would hold the Urim and Thummim in it. Don't know if that's true, but interesting that the shield of David, which is what most Jewish scholars refer to it as, is the that Star of David there. I think that we're going to find, if we really look through, and there will be a lot of evidences, and I've found more than this. I'm just pointing this out. This is just one, but I think we're going to find dozens and dozens and dozens of these kind of symbols that are going to, again, knowing that a correlation in and of itself doesn't prove anything, but a number of correlations indicates that there's some kind of significant relationship. relationship. Okay, let's go. Oh, that was wrong. Okay. All right. That's the one. And are there sheep? You were mentioning sheep. I thought you might appreciate this little photo. Those are sheep. Those are bighorn sheep. And guess where that picture was taken? In Sierra Madres del Sur, right on the border of Mexico and Guatemala. Did they bring sheep with them? I think they could have. And you know, there are two periods of 150 years approximately of extended famine. Now, it didn't mean they didn't have anything to eat, but it meant they abandoned the cities in a single day in many of those places and went out and had to live off the jungles. If you had any domesticated animal at all, it's lunch, okay, or dinner. But it's going to be probably eaten during those extended periods of famine. And that could also include horses or whatever they could get their hands on. They say the fastest animal currently in Africa is the Ethiopian chicken, because they're starving over there, right? And so the chicken's got to be pretty fast. All right. And I don't mean in light of their difficulties. I just thought it was kind of note of humor. Well, maybe that could have come out a little bit better, but we're looking at the Babylonian calendar here, and the Babylonian calendar, the Jews adopted the Babylonian. When Lehi left Jerusalem, the pre-exilic time, when he left, the months of the Jewish calendar were known only by their numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 12. It's a lunar calendar, and it was only known by that. The Jews on the right-hand side here, while they're in the captivity, they adopt the Babylonian names for their months on the calendar, which is white there, and you can't quite see that as well as I'd like you to. But the first month is always called that Nisan there. It's called spring. Aviv or Abib, either one means spring. So sometimes you say, well, didn't they have the name for the first month? It was called spring. Well, it meant spring. Did you know that pre-exilic Jews were paranoid about keeping Exodus chapter 12, which was the first commandment the Lord gave them on the Passover, that they had to do it. The first month of the year had to be in spring, and that's when their calendar had to begin. But they didn't use the vernal equinox at that time, the March 21st thing, but they did in the Babylonian captivity. And also when the Jews came here to America, that the calendars were already, 11 different calendars or whatever, and that they adopted the also here because they had the vernal equinox, the March 21st thing. They had it here in the New World already as well, and other kind of things that go along with that. But anyway, they adopted that calendar, and it becomes very significant because here's how it relates to the Book of Mormon, for example. If we know what the first month of the year is, we know when Amalickiah died, because it says that Amalickiah was killed on the last day of the last month, and that they found his body on the first day of the first month of the next year. He dies in 25 and 26, okay? So what are we going to, that is a way to say, oh, that's interesting. So and it says that he was killed, of course, because he had been working in the heat of the day. Well, now let's see. That means that he would have been killed sometime around within an 11-day period of time from March 21st, approximately. So where is the heat of the day in March? New York, heat of the day, March. You have to think March, okay? And where do we find on the East Coast there the heat of the day? I'm saying that there are implications and there are very strong, I think, conclusions that you can come to, because if you have a correct assumption, you can have a correct conclusion generally. But if you have a false assumption, it doesn't matter what you're going to say, because your conclusions are probably going to be false anyway. But the idea here is that we have, I think, evidence now, very clear evidence, that the Jews here followed that Babylonian calendar in the old world. But Lehi comes out and he names the months. He doesn't call them. You're not going to find any of the Hebrew names there. 2,400 years they use those names. They don't use them in the Book of Mormon. They call it the first month or the commencement of the year. They call it the last. But we have like the first, the second, the fifth, the sixth, the 10th, 11th months as well are all named in the Book of Mormon. And it would have been, they would have used a 12-month lunar calendar, and then they would have adjusted it because they were Jews and they would follow the law of Moses, which required them to do that. I want to say more about that, but I'm not going to, or I won't get done. How about that? All right? just this much on the calendar. If you look at, this is this year's Jewish calendar, just to give you an idea. March 21st, April 19th, that's going to be the first month, and then goes all the way down like this. So we can correlate. We can look at the, say, oh, okay, if that's really the case, and we know what the months are, and if the Lamanites are coming to battle in the 10th month, and they're wearing loincloths, and they're naked, and their heads are shaved, they're probably not going to New York. Buffalo, New York, in January or February, naked, except for a loincloth. Yeah, I've mentioned that before, but I'm just going to tell you, if I were a Nephite general, I'd say, save your arrows, boys. They'll be frozen in 5 minutes when you get up in that area. Anyway, there's a lot of implications when you know the dates on the calendar, and you can correlate that. So when you read the Book of Mormon, and it says it's the fourth month or the fifth or the ninth or the tenth month, and Ammon Amulek in the tenth month on the tenth day of that month, the different things are going to happen there, then you can kind of correlate. Say, oh, yeah. And so if it's the tenth month, somewhere around the last part of December, the early part of January, and they're out and they're left naked, this is the case, they don't know loincloth. They're left naked for several days, and they keep coming back, and at least five times they smite them. That had better be a climate that's conducive to warmer weather, or they would be frozen. They would die from exposure, period. Just die from that. That would be enough to do it. Yeah, yep, that's right. Okay, here we go. Another implication, killing Laban. This is just one point. There's lots of reasons here, but behold, the Lord hath delivered him into thy hands. That is something in the Western mind we don't get. We don't get it, but you're going to find it 192 times in the Old Testament where, but now there's more than that, that you'll find that delivered and delivereth and all that, but 192 times it's talking about being delivered into or out of the hands of. And you'll find it 159 times in the Book of Mormon. It's a concept that's in the Eastern mind. It's not in our mind. So the Lord delivered him into your hands. Now, what this says in the Law of Moses is, and if a man lie not in wait, you killed him, they lie not in wait, but God delivered him into his hands, then I will appoint thee a place whither he shall flee. It's the Red Sea. And they're going to take that and go from there. All right, let's move on. This is the other reasons why. I'm glad you read that. Good. Those are all the reasons, the justification that he gave for killing. But as you look at this, I want to go through this really quickly because I want to get to one other point here. We have to wrap it up. Sherem is going to accuse Jacob of blasphemy. Well, you say, what's all the big deal? So freedom of speech. No. The penalty, if he's found guilty, that is if Jacob was found guilty of blasphemy, the penalty there in Leviticus 24:16 is death by stoning. Or at the minimum, death, all right? So, but here's the thing. If you're a false witness, then Deuteronomy 19:19 says that whatever you would have befallen the person that you bore a false witness to, let me read it to you here. Then shall ye do unto him as he had thought to have done unto his brother, so shall thou put away evil from among you. So the fate of a false witness was to have to suffer whatever the person he bore false witness against would have suffered, which in this case is death, and so Sherem is going to forfeit his life, but that's under the law of Moses. See, we may not get it, but I'm telling you, it's under the law of Moses, and you see it there. The same is true with Zemnariah. Zemnariah is going to get hung on a tree, and you know who the, if you want to get into the individual legalistic cases, that's where Jack Welch, I talked to Jack this last week, he's back in Philadelphia today giving a lecture back there, and he wishes he could be here with us, but I talked to him about that, but I recommend his books on the legal cases, the Book of Mormon. He does a great job with that. The Jack Welch, John, it's written under John, but you know. Now here you have, but Zerahemna, he's going to be hung from a tree, and then it says, however, very clearly, let me read this to you here. This is also now in Deuteronomy 21. And if a man have committed a sin worthy of death, and he be put to death, and thou hang him on a tree. Now this is what's going to happen with Zemnariah. He's going to get hung on the tree, and at the same time, you have to cut the tree down. And so they're going to cut the tree down because it says, his body shall not remain at night upon the tree, but thou shalt in any wise bury him that day. And you know what's ironic about that? Christ was crucified on a tree. We call it a tree, right? A cross. And he was taken down the same day. But that's just, that's nothing to do with Book of Mormon per se, but I just thought it was interesting. Anyway, Zebnariah, he's the head of the Gadianton robbers, or at least one of the leaders, and kind of the mafia type people there, but he's going to suffer a fate that is outlined in the Law of Moses. So how does the Law of Moses impact on the Book of Mormon? Incredibly, incredibly. I mean, these people are living that law. So the more we understand about the Law of Moses, but I think rather than say, well, I'm going to study Jewish tradition to understand the Law of Moses, I don't think that's the best way to do it. I think you read the Book of Mormon and then compare it to the Old Testament, you'll have a better understanding, because the way they lived it in the Book of Mormon is the way it ought to have been lived, not by the other traditions. Anyway, we come down here, Korihor, short story on Korihor. He's guilty of both being a blasphemer and false witness. Hasta la vista, baby. So he's gone, and he dies by foot stomping, which I thought was an interesting thing, but this, we're going to move on. I want to come to the Babylonian Jews. I want you to see that when they were in Jerusalem, or when they left Jerusalem, and they go over, first of all, under the Babylonian influence, I don't think they followed Nebo. I don't think they followed the god Bel. I don't think any of those. But when the Persians came over, Cyrus became a model of the Savior. He's going to save the, in fact, there are people in the Jewish literature that I've read that call Cyrus a Messiah. Whoa. But he became an image of what they thought the Messiah was going to be. Not the Book of Mormon image of the Lamb, who's going to come and take care of the spiritual needs of his people, but more of this political Savior who's going to come and gather all the Jewish people together, and he's going to be a political Savior. See, and that's what Cyrus was. But also, here, very quickly, that's what happened. They lose that. I'm going to move on because I want to get to lots of stuff here. Oh, Zoroastrian. Oh, good. Let's go to there, and I'll try to wrap up on that. Book of Esther. I love Esther. I love the Book of Esther. But this is one of those examples of what's added to the Law of Moses. This, the Esther is what, probably one of the most controversial books of the Bible. And it may be because 190 references are to the kings of Persia, and there's no reference to God. And that may be why the Essenes of the Dead Sea Scrolls, and on the shores of the Dead Sea there, the Essenes, why they don't have a copy. They have multiple copies of Isaiah and everything else. The book they don't have is Esther, all right? And so they didn't accept that. But it promotes the idea of a political savior. So Esther, even though she's a woman, promotes this idea and the book of saving the Jewish people. And I understand that. I understand that that's a part of what the Messiah is going to do when he comes to the Mount of Olives and all that. That's a part of it. But he's a world savior. He's the savior of all the world and the whole universe here. So it's not a national thing, and it's not just a lion thing there, and that's what these people came back with from that, is that kind of an image. The name of the Messiah in the Zoroastrianism belief, Zarathustra is the name of the prophet, that's why they call it Zoroastrianism, is Shaoshant. And Shaoshant is this political leader who's going to come back and benevolently gather things, and that's, so that is a Persian notion. Has not out of the Old Testament at all. It's very Persian. When the Jews come back, and now they're back in the under Ezra and Nehemiah, and it's going to be over hundreds of years of time, they're going to develop the Talmuds and the Mishnah and the all of the traditions, the yarmulke and the prayer shawls and all. They're going to get added on. And one last thought, and that's this. This is where the Savior is going to say to them in Matthew 23, you've omitted the weightier matters of the law. You've missed judgment and love and mercy and faith. You've missed that. And not that you should have left the others undone, but you've missed that basic message. The Book of Mormon doesn't miss it. The Book of Mormon has that message in it. And that's what's so profound and so wonderful about the Book of Mormon. I have a testimony of that. The thing that I wanted to kind of point out about this Zoroastrianism thing is that they really did have that image, so that when the very Christ came among them, they couldn't see him. What's the Sabbath day's journey? Well, a group of rabbis sat together. That's plural of rabbi. A group of rabbis sent together, and they said, well, you know, it was 1,000 paces from where the tents were to where the Ark of the Covenant was, and so they surely had to go worship. So we're going to say that a Sabbath day's journey is 2,000 steps, about 2,000 cubits from here to here. So about 2,000 steps, and that's a Sabbath day's journey. Well, now add that 100 times and then multiply it another 100 times, and they became so many of those things that well-meaning people said, you know what, I want to keep the intent of the law. So what I'm going to do is, I've got my daughter and she lives 3,000 steps away, so I really want to visit her on the Sabbath day. So I'm going to take 1,999 steps, and I've got an old chair I'm really not using. I'm going to break off a leg and put a piece of that chair down there. Now I'm still can take another 2,000 steps because I'm still within my property. There were piles of furniture stuck around. And multiply that 100-fold, and you'll see why they could not recognize the Messiah when he came among them. I love the Jewish people, and I pray for them, and I pray for the Lord to bless them as I pray that he'll bless all of us and have a personal testimony of Jesus Christ and of the Book of Mormon. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. I tried it on time. I hope that's all right.
That's great. You know, my dad used to say, life is short, eat dessert first. Well, we're at our lunch break, but we've had dessert already. And John, thank you so much for sharing with us.
Well, thank you, and I appreciate that.
Gift from BMAF.
I'm looking forward.